l'UNESCO pour le 11 novembre. Merci. Test au micro UNESCO, 11 novembre. Test, test. Premier jour, né. Salle 7. Régisseur. Essai technique.
Okay, good morning to everyone. Can you hear me? Okay, you can hear me. So welcome to this annual meeting of the Dynamic Coalition on Community Connectivity. I apologize for the room, first of all. In UN buildings, there are either very microscopic rooms or huge rooms, so we had the microscopic one this time. It's quite cozy so far. I hope we will not have too many newcomers, otherwise there are still, if you want, there are two chairs here and one, I'm keeping one for Jane here. First of all, a couple of words about what is this coalition doing and why we are here. We were born 3 years ago, actually almost 4 years ago, because after, I mean, it was the follow-up of a workshop, the first workshop that was organized on community networks in Jean Pessoa in IGF 2015. There was a need to cooperate more, to try to work together to advance knowledge on community networks. There are many people already that are working on this around the world since more than 20 years, but there was no common point of synergy, of communication, of cooperation. We created it with this coalition. There are still some chairs. There is a couple of chairs here if you want. So we have been starting doing research, organizing events, and doing internet governance. If internet governance is the stakeholders coming together and defining common plans, common rules, common norms, common procedures, it's exactly what we are doing. We haven't only produced three very valuable reports with stories, with examples, with models on community networks. We have also produced a declaration, which is in the as an annex of this book, which is the our annual report, is the third. And in particularly, come here, Jane. I'm particularly proud not only to say that this is the third book that we produce, but that finally we have a book with instructions on how to build community networks, on how to enjoy what I used to call network self-determination, which is the freedom to build network infrastructure as a commons and to use it to enjoy your human rights. This is something that everyone should have, and the common international human rights law and principle already afford you. It's you should have the freedom to build your own network and to enjoy it and to use it to enjoy your human rights. So I'm particularly proud, not only because this is an example of how people together can coordinate and produce things. Actually, Felix, there is a chair here, I think. I'm very proud also because this coalition has demonstrated that people are creating partnerships. It's not only a matter of research. This book this year is co-sponsored also by the ITU, which is the UN agency for telecoms and ICTs. And the fact that we have managed to arouse the interest of the ITU in this, it's by itself a huge success. It would have not been possible without the help, the time, the dedication of every person that has authored this book, the previous book, and that spends dedicated time to advance the common interest for the people, by the people, and that not only on the DC3 list. I mean, not only DC3 is a very good example of how these things could be done. I consider it as a virtual community network, because it's really where people put together their effort, their synergy for the common good. So I don't want to steal too much time to all the community network heroes that are here, that are going to explain you their contributions. I would like to ask Jane to say a couple of words about how the ISOC also has been su- supporting us and the initiative that we are being that we have developed together. As we had some changes in the panelists, I would ask the panelists to introduce themselves. Because given the configuration of the room and the changes, I'm not able to find them all. So it's better if you just can you just raise your hand now if you're a panelist, so that I can identify you. And okay, excellent. Okay, perfect. And so as we are a lot, and as the mag keeps on cutting our time at our disposal, I think this is a quite. They make also the room smaller. So there will be also, so please write at igf@un.org to complain. And please go to the main session on dynamic coalitions tomorrow. I will not be able to be there because I will be in another panel to complain and to ask to have 90 minutes and a bigger room if possible. So without further ado, let me give the floor to Jane and thank you for all your help.
Sure, and I'll be very, very brief. There are some other people in this room, Raul Echeverria, who's our vice president from Global, Sebastian Bella Gamba, who is running our CN campaign. The Internet Society celebrated a partnership with the Digital Empowerment Foundation, our first community network work, 2 weeks ago in Delhi. And I think one of the things that both Osama Manzar, who's here, I believe, and Raj Singh, who's our bureau director from the Asia Pacific, would say is, this is for the community, with the community, by the community. What ISOC is trying to do is work with partners, work with communities to support them. We aren't trying to speak for community networks, but with. As quoted on the back of the book, our CEO, Andrew Sullivan, who's just new, has said that the internet is for everyone, which is our vision. And so everyone in this room and everyone around the world deserves connectivity. And as said in other sessions, half the world's not connected. So we need to do something about that. Community networks are a way to do that from the regulatory policy development and technical perspectives. So stay tuned for more. It's a great partnership with Luca and others here. Thank you for everything that you're doing, because a lot of what you do is volunteer work, and sometimes people don't recognize what you do. You spend a lot of your own time and energy, sometimes money, doing this. So if we can help support you more in the future, that's our intention. But I'll stop now because you want to hear from everyone else.
Excellent. Thank you. And thank you very much for being brief and for respecting the quite short time schedule we have. Before getting into the book, there is also I would like to ask Carla, with whom we have drafted this other, we could say, outcome of DC3, a parallel outcome about this paper on how community networks are evolving in Latin America, and that we are launching this week, also with the support of ISOC, APC, FGV, and Rizomatica. So just if you could, in a couple of minutes, explain the work we have been doing, so that then we can dig into the book.
Thank you, Luca. I'll be very, very brief. I want to thank you and ISOC for having this opportunity and present a bit of our paper on community networks in Latin America, challenges, regulations, and solutions. As Luca said, it will be available in the next few weeks online. And mostly, this paper shows how in the last years a growing number of community networks have appeared in the Latin America background, proving to be an alternative based on community connectivity for connecting the unconnected. We talk about how governments have had difficulties in designing and implementing policies to connect the unconnected, and how market agents have also failed on offering access to a substantial part of the world's population. Moreover, this paper also highlights the regulatory elements that can optimize its development, as well as show the regulatory experiences that have allowed its functioning and which have faced obstacles in Latin America. So looking forward to the launch of this paper, and we'll go back to you.
And then just to add something, very importantly, I think what is meaningful in the paper is that we show that over the past 30 years, the policies that have been experimented have shown to have limits. They are maybe very good for urban areas with high income people, but they simply not work for the 50% of people that live in not in urban areas and have or that have lower income. So community network maybe are not a silver bullet, but they are a very good opportunity to be seized to try to bridge digital divides. And how to do so? So first, for the first time, we have a book explaining how to do so, and we hope also to translate it in other languages. The ITU also is interested in sponsoring the translation, so it's something that we can, of course, speak more later. I would like to start with Spencer, who has drafted a very good chapter with his colleagues, and I will let you explain the details of this guide.
Thank you. Hi everyone, my name is Spencer. I'm a research scientist at the University of Washington. And in this chapter of the book, it kind of talks about some work that we've been doing over the past year in building out small-scale community LTE networks. So we spent the last year essentially started with a somewhat functional open source LTE stack, made it more functional, kind of got it running as like a network in the box type of an approach, paired it up with some hardware, and then went and partnered up with a community in Papua and went out there for a couple months this summer, built it, set it up, turned it on. Runs pretty well right now. We've got about 10 users, kind of still a test batch, still ironing out some of the bugs, crashes, comes back, does okay. Let's see, it's been really well received. So we've been getting constant requests, can we add more users? And we're saying, hang on, we're trying to fix this as fast as we can. We've been bringing in about $600 a month right now, just off of these users. They are finding a lot of good value over it, and they're essentially running it and setting the rates and the day-to-day maintenance themselves. That's the kind of the gist of it. The book chapter deals with basically all the instructions of how to grab this stack, how to download it, and get it up and running. So thanks a lot. I don't really have much else to say on that, just kind of a quick pitch.
Excellent. So thank you for being very brief. I appreciate it very much.
Exactly.
So as we have a lot of speakers, you do not need to be so brief, but thank you very much if you are concise. Thank you very much. And actually this shows that there are a lot of different approaches, and it's also very good to have new people. There is a core of people that is over the past 3 years being participating in the activities, but it's very good to have also fresh new ideas coming in and oxygenating also the way we think. So I would ask also to another a new entry, Stavrola, to give a quick overview of what the work they are doing with the MASI project. Stavrola, do you need a presentation?
No, leave it like that. I'm Stavrola Manglavera, coming from Greece, University of Thessaly, and I'm the coordinators of a MASI project that we created. The MASI toolkit is included in the manual. MASI, let's start from that, means together in the Greek language. That is the reason of the name of our project and the toolkit. The toolkit that we have created is based on open software, open hardware, and empowers people to create their own networks and to be connected through very simple technology and very cheap in order to communicate between them. The motivation for MASI is that people fear digital technologies, and there are on the mainstream internet there are problems with data privacy, lack of social aspect, and the top-down approach. This toolkit gives the opportunity to be engaged the other way around with a top bottom-up approach. We have been these last 3 years developing a toolkit, and we've managed to have other out of our project several pilots around the globe using and set up the MASI Zone. MASI Zone is the whole stuff that includes the guidelines, the infrastructure, and the application to be used by the MASI toolkit. You can find much more detail in the manual or at our website. And people, we managed to have pilots in the favelas of Rio. There are already 10 MASI zones that they have been, they supported from the British Council, and they installed their own MASI zone and they're using it from their own internet connectivity. And have installations in the Museum of Natural History in Berlin, and the federal government of Germany were so satisfied about using this for explaining the visitors how to enjoy the museum. And of course we have other Mazi zones that are installed in Greece, in Switzerland, in UK, in Germany, in several places, in Zambia nowadays, that they are using a Mazi zone for exchange of well care and medical issues that they are dealing there with in their country. So for whatever information or additional stuff you need, I'm here to further discuss it.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Trevor. And also thank you very much for also pointing out that although Mazi is a EU-funded project, you are also doing some installation out of EU. And for instance, in Rio de Janeiro, in the communities where you are installing, this really changes life of people. I mean, people that are, have to decide between being unemployed and cut out of virtually any opportunity in life, start to be connected, be entrepreneur, go to school. That is really a game changer for people, and especially for youngsters. Keeping on discussing how to create the community networks, I would like to ask to Nicholas, we can maybe share our... Nicholas also brought toys to play. So they have done an amazing project together with also other friends and colleagues on how to build a router. Not only your network, but also your router. So the Libre router. So without any further ado, please, Nico, explain us how to do so.
Okay. So in the current book, we talked about the process to build this thing, the Libre router, which actually started from talks we had with some people in this room and out of this room, and it was initially funded by Frida, Kara is here, and it then got also funding from Fire Africa, and it's currently entering what we call phase two, which is supported by ISOC. And it was a long journey to get here. With what I brought here is the last prototype. It's so this thing is the current version of the Libre router, which is a multi-radio router that is specifically designed for mesh networking. And the most important thing in this router is not just the hardware, which is important enough, but also the software stack. What we tried to develop with this solution, with Libre Router and Libre Mesh, which is the software that runs in this particular hardware, is for people with no knowledge in networking to be able to deploy their own networks. So the whole idea with this device is that people should be able to just take a Libre router, mount it on a pole on top of the roof, and as long as they have visibility to another neighbor who is installing another Libre router, then they will start meshing, and the village will connect from house to house. So this project involves the hardware part, it also involves the software part, and also a documentation section, because we found that it was also lacking to have easy documentation for people with no specific knowledge on this particular problem. So our documentation, it's also shown a bit in the book, helps not only with the technical stuff, but also with how to organize, how to start a community network, how to divide the work, different approaches to sustainability. So at this point in time, what we believe is the most important thing to do in the future, because we are having like a lot of demand. The router is not yet available in production, in mass production. We hope to have the first run in next month, but we already have more than 3,000 units that have been, that communities have said they would like to buy. They are not pre-ordered because there is not a pre-order system, but we had a survey and the community said, yeah, we want lots of these things. So what we think is very important is to have a support system. And so the LibreRouter phase two is very much focused on this, on a support system that will help people not only communicate with a support team outside their community, but also to organize the support tasks inside the community. Because we, from the work we do on the ground, we have seen that this is very problematic usually. For the people to organize how to take care of the different issues that they identify in the network. So the idea is that this will bubble up. Like if it cannot be solved locally, then it can be solved regionally, and if it cannot be solved regionally, then the external support will help. We call the cavalry. So, well, it needs to be short, right?
Yes, unfortunately, yes. There is, I mean, just for those who are interested in the book, there are also a lot of references of all the sites to download all the further material. I've already uploaded the book, the free online version of the page of this workshop. Unfortunately, the IGF website is currently under DDoS attack. So, but I will tweet it as soon as I will have connectivity, because unfortunately I don't have it here now, but I will tweet it this afternoon, or we will share it. Everything is online, will be online for free. So now let's pass to the second segment of this book, which is how to make community networks sustainable, scalable, and law compliant. And then the last part will be about interactions with potential partners. Muicheng also is here. I don't know if Esmeralda is here or not, but I see Dawn is here. So we will have also interaction with, and everyone that is here and has potential ideas for partnership will be very much welcome to speak. So now I will have Roger, who is there. So Roger, who has been working for years, almost maybe a decade more, less, with the GIFINET Foundation, and he's our renowned expert on scalability and sustainability, together with also Leandro Navarro, who is there, and has they've decided to let Roger illustrate their work.
Okay, thanks. So we were asked to write a chapter about scalability. Scalability is important, and maybe we were asked to do so because we come from a community network that has some tens of thousands of nodes, and we are not just doing Wi-Fi, but we are also doing fiber. Right now it's 50-50 or so, so half fiber, half Wi-Fi. We started Wi-Fi like probably 13 years ago. In 2009 we started with fiber, and we tried to prove if the same model or something similar could also work. So if, again, the people were able to build their own network infrastructure now using fiber, and it's possible. So the chapter has a classical structure. We have an introduction where we discuss why scaling up. For us, it's crucial. Then we have a look into the four axes, the main considerations for scaling up, which are for us are social, legal, economic, and technological, plus a fifth with is the cross-disciplinary, because it's very important the connection of all these four fields. And finally, we had a look into the external support, because it's also crucial to have good external support. And it concludes with the conclusions, obviously. So we have an annex explaining what is GIFINET, just some words, because I think it's important to understand the context. This is already done, I did it. So why scaling up? And the answer, it's because the easy answer is the bigger, the stronger we are. And this is the main reason. There are four sub main reasons, let's say, or we have identified them. The first is the joy of sharing. I think this is something that motivates us all together here. The second is the economic sustainability. It's important to become sustainable from all these considerations we said, but especially economically, because in this globalized context we are, it's something that is crucial. And here we discuss how to reach the breaking point, we call it, the sustainability. We have to at least grow until to a certain point to make this scalable, sustainable. The third, what is this? My mobile phone, yeah, sorry. It's not mine.
There are many phones.
Okay. So, the third is strengthen self-protection. And here we are able to specialize and get the knowledge in some areas and then contact the rest, because we know we should also share this, and this is how we can reach or become more resilient. And the last is again related to economy, the efficiency. Aggregating demands creates economies of scale, and this is very important, and especially when we move from the very last mile into the last mile and then into the middle mile. It's crucial to aggregate demands. And just to finish the acknowledgements, we appreciate the work of especially DC3 and guide by or chair by Luca, not only for chairing in general, but the excellent, at least in our case, the editing job he did, because we received amazing comments. It was great. I think the quality improved significantly. And then also thanks to ISOC. I think it's important for what we have discussed to scale, to have global impact, and to have global impact we need organizations like ISOC, and especially people like Jane Coffin or Christian O'Flaherty, and of course with the support of Raúl Echevarría, because we need the support of the head. So thanks, and that's it, more or less. Here we are.
Thank you very much, and also thank you very much to explain that community networks are not only for small villages, but can also scale, can be also implemented in major cities. They are already implemented and they are already scaling, and GIFINET is a wonderful example of this. And of course, as I was saying before, if we see DC3 as a community network, we are scaling up and we are all putting our little part to scale up, and I think this is very, very good to see. Speaking about scalability and sustainability, and also how to federate community networks. Where is Felix? Oh yes, surprise! Felix has done an excellent job analyzing Fédération FDN, and I will let him explain this very good example here in France.
So basically my chapter deals with the French Federation of Community Networks. It's called FFDN. It was born in 2011, and basically it was an association, a not-profit organization coordinating various organizations around France doing community networking. There are 34 organizations at the moment in various parts of France. And what's interesting with FFDN, basically all the member community networks are non-profit and volunteer-driven, so much less professionalized, for instance, than a GIFI network is. And what's interesting is that the federation basically coordinates the work of 30 plus organizations that are very different in terms of, you know, their environment. Some are set in urban or rural settings. They can do radio, fiber, or even lease the landline infrastructures of incumbent telecom operators, but still manage the connectivity, so they're part of the community network movement. And basically, the federation has been key in bringing support, self-help, and mutual aid between the various member organizations. They've coordinated various litigation actions from emanating from the community networks, and they had several challenges, for instance, against surveillance laws in France, and are now moving to trying to have better terms to access existing infrastructures and facilitate the deployment of their networks. So I'll stop here because I'd like to add a word to Virginie's presentation on legal aspects, but basically FFDN is one of the many examples and models through which at the organizational level community networks can scale up, and I think it's an interesting model even for the international and transnational coordination of community networks, because it unites very diverse organizations and basically has a standard document, a charter, enumerating the values of the communities, but it's not much more than that. Otherwise, it's very very much a duocracy and works in a very flexible manner, and I think it can be a good inspiration for other coordination efforts.
Excellent, and thank you very much to highlight the fact that besides being feasible and scalable, can also be federated community networks, and this actually adds strength to the movement. And I also, your presentation is a good segue to then ask Virginie to provide some insights on how on their guide, the guide they have elaborated on how to be law compliant with regard to the European regulation. That is, some elements can also be an inspiration for other regulatory framework, of course. And actually, I think a good, very good idea is would be also to further develop this work to see how in other countries could be also applied. But please, Virginie, go ahead.
Thanks. Good morning to you all. I'm Virginie. I come from the University of Trento, and I work for the NetCommon project for the legal parts. And in my spare time, I also part of the community network in France. So yeah, today we would like to talk about sustainability of community network. And with Mélanie Lyon-Doronet, we feel that in order to foster it, we have to introduce you to the main legal obligation of community networks. Also, we wanted to give concrete guidelines for community network in order to cope with this requirement while respecting fundamental rights such as privacy and net neutrality. So, in order to do this, we focus on the European legal framework so that it will be applicable to all community network in Europe. And we try to cover three main topics: civil liability, data protection law, and data retention law, which is a very thorny issue. Also, we wanted to give a few tips regarding governance, but not only based on legal obligation, but also in reliance with experience and practices of other community networks, because we rely on a survey that we did last year, and we ask a lot of community networks how they deal with that different legal obligation. And I think that will be all, because we have to be quick. Thank you very much for your attention.
And Felix also has something to complement.
Yeah, I mean, I'm also part of the NetCommons project, as several people around the table. And just to complement on what Virginie said, a key aspect of community networks in terms of ensuring their legal sustainability is also to develop a capacity to influence the way telecom policy is made. And to that purpose, with NetCommons and community networks in Europe, in partnership also and building on the efforts of other organizations like the coalition, of course, ISOC, we've started last year, basically, to release an open letter. letter basically making a list of demands in terms of the evolution of the telecom policy regulatory framework. As the EU, the European Union, was engaging in a major overhaul of the telecom policy framework, and that has paid off. The law is still to be formally adopted, but the last compromise brings several improvements for community networks in terms of developing special regulations tailored for these initiatives, in terms of releasing more spectrum, releasing also these organizations from administrative burdens that are legitimate when applied to major incumbent corporations, but not to what are often volunteer-driven initiatives. All of this to say that we have also following these new legal evolutions, put together policy guidelines intended for European policymakers in the telecom field, and that will be released sometime today. I will circulate it on the coalition's mailing list, and we hope to translate these guidelines so that community networks can appropriate this document and engage a dialogue with policymakers so that the regulatory environment improves in the coming months and years.
Yeah, and actually that is a very good point that deserves to be reiterated. I mean, the problem that community networks are sometimes do not find at all a regulatory framework that is adapted to them is simply that they have never been considered by policymakers. It's not a matter of bad faith. Very frequently, simply a matter of ignorance, but ignorance really in the literal sense of the word, ignoring the existence of something. So we have seen that actually regulators may be very receptive when they start to dialogue with people doing research or developing community networks. In Argentina, for example, a law has been adopted in August on how to allow community networks to be established, being regulated. In Brazil, Anatel, the regulator, has withdrawn the obligation to register and to have a license for small operators, which is excellent because it allows community networks not to have the same regulatory and financial burden of big operators. And that is very good and it's very easy to implement. And also regulators are quite keen on doing so as soon as they understand the benefits of community networks. Now, let's go to the last segment before opening the floor. There is Mui Chang, and that maybe want to say something, or Don, or both. I don't know who, maybe the Mui Chang, please, so about the fact that IFLA and its partners, Mui Chang is from Bibliothèque Sans Frontières, they are developing also an open access toolkit for libraries. And I think we have been speaking over the past years about enhancing cooperation with the librarians community, which would be extraordinarily beneficial both for community networks and for librarians. So, Mui Chang, if you want to say a couple of words about the work that you are developing.
Thank you very much for having us here, and I think Don would complete what I would say. I'm very honored to be here to represent with Don and Esmeralda the offline internet consortium. My name is Mui Chang. I work as an education director at Libraries Without Borders, and we convene a small gathering in January 2018 to discuss the challenges of offering access to internet and to high quality and relevant digital content to population around the world, because we all strongly believed with the 20 other organizations that were there that access to information is a fundamental human right and that it is the basis for democracy and the basis for democratic participation. And so together with other organizations such as the IFLA, the Arizona State University KiWiX that provides the offline version of Wikipedia, or people like Learning Quality that built a learning management system to provide access to educational content worldwide, we try to find a way of collaborating in a better way, because we are all developing software solutions that enable people around the world, regardless of the context, in refugee camps, in developing countries, in indigenous communities, etc., to access digital content, educational, informational, recreational, etc. But the thing is that most of these apps do not interoperate with each other, because these are small organizations that try to build whatever is working for their context. But most of these apps, when you don't have high technical levels, you cannot really own them and install them in a way that is user-friendly for non-expert users. And so what we're working at the moment is trying to develop a common layer of services, sort of a platform onto which apps could plug into and interoperate, so that, for instance, you could have a learning management system next to Wikipedia, next to an app that provides information for disaster-affected population, etc. And all of that would be interoperated onto a software, onto a hardware, sorry, that could be anything that you guys in community networks are working with. And so the idea now is that we're working on this prototype, and we're more than ever looking for partners in order to really scale that and make sure that the solution is relevant to any context. And so these are a few of the features that we're trying to implement onto this platform, are things such as mutualized search, so that a user, when he's looking for specific information, can search across all the apps that exist in an offline way, or single sign-on, so that a user does not need to have several logins and usernames to access all of these services, or simply incremental updates, so that whenever you have access to internet, you can update the content, but when you don't, it works in a standalone way. And so we're at the moment looking for partners who may be willing to work with us on the technical side, because we're working on this prototype that should be released in the spring of 2019. And we're looking for partners who would help us develop this prototype, but we'll test it in the field, because the idea is really that it can work anywhere in any kind of context. And so I feel like synergies with community networks are definitely very, very essential. And we're as well looking for people who can curate content, because having the infrastructure is great, but having the relevant content for the relevant populations is actually what we're aiming for. So please feel free to come to us. And Don, maybe you may want to add some things that I may have forgotten, or talk about the toolkit from the IFLA that you know much better than I.
And while Don goes to the mic, I just want to say that, of course, this kind of synergy of cooperation could be mutual, meaning that people that are developing community networks will be super interested in having more access to knowledge. But also, what could be also interesting is to share in the network of librarians instructions on how to build community networks, so that we try to create a sort of virtuous circle where people have more access to knowledge, thanks to which they have access on how to create connectivity, thanks to which they have more access to knowledge and opportunities. And I think that is the final goal. Please don't go ahead.
Thank you, Luca. Thank you, Jane, and everybody. I'll be the first one to second that you need a bigger room for the IGF. We have MAG representatives here at least, so they're hearing it. I represent today, I guess I would say, the Partnership for Public Access. And this is defined as a strategy to integrate three approaches that we think should be able to accommodate anyone, anywhere. Even the farthest places, as Muichang has just identified. So this offline internet, which is some people struggle with the concept, but I think Muichang just explained it very well. Also community networks, which doesn't need explaining here, and public access facilities, hubs, libraries, where people can actually go and get help, which is essential to most people as new users, and how these three approaches support each other and reinforce each other and offer some kind of a solution to almost any circumstance. The thing I would add about community networks that we've been working on particularly relates to the use of TV white space, either to reach public access centers, libraries, or through them, if they have backhaul, then to extend that connectivity out into the community to public access points. Specifically for community networks, I would add an application or a use case, and you make the point about it's not just about unconnected villages, cities. There are many people that are not connected in the cities. And so we're looking at the use case as a redundant network. Sitting on top of a community that's already has some level of connectivity, principally for redundancy, for increased resilience against disaster. So if you have a backup network, you're calling these second nets. So we know, understand about first responder communications. Well, these facilities, schools, libraries, et cetera, play roles as second responders in disaster scale events. And so the community network topology, I guess we would say, would be direct wireless connections between these facilities that could operate ad hoc if need be and provide tremendous value in those circumstances to help change the conversation from nice to have advantages to access to health information and so forth to critical information in times of intense need. So we're happy to be part of the community networks network and to be here, and thank you for the time.
Thank you very much for this, Don. And now we have been wonderful in time management, so we have 12 minutes to open the floor and discuss. So please, before I open the floor, do all authors have a copy of this? All the authors of this book in this room have a copy of this? So, okay, so we will give one to Roger and one as a gift to Glenn, and to Virginie. There is one from Virginie here. Okay, and there is one left. So I will leave one there on the center, at the center, and you will be able to fight for it. So, sorry. Okay, before we open the fight, which will be probably will be the best part of the session, I will open the floor for everyone to have questions and remarks. So if you have any questions and remarks, first here, and then two, three, and four. And five.
Thanks so much, Talan Sultan from ISO Kyrgyz chapter. And thanks to this CN network, I met with the community in IGF at Guadalajara and got inspired that today we're implementing two projects in Kyrgyzstan. One is a community network in a very remote mountainous village, which is really cut off from the civilization during the winter times because of the snow. But it's a very touristy place. So hopefully soon they will have a real fiber optic network inside the village. And the second is a project called Bilim Bulagi, which is translated as a spring of knowledge. And we want to bring internet to libraries and schools in villages which have no internet at the moment. So the content in local language, like Wikipedia or Khan Academy videos in Kyrgyz language, we download into a hard disk and connect it to some Orange Pi or something like that device and bring it to the villages and libraries, hoping that we would turn libraries into community centers again so the villagers could come and use the content. So we'd be really happy to cooperate with all the partners here, and to, of course, there are many challenges that we are learning, and we'd like to not to repeat the same mistakes, and also later on we'd like to share our experience. Thank you.
Yeah, excellent, and very good to see that also the work we are doing is inspiring also other people, and I really encourage you to speak with all the people here after the session. I will not be able to stay here until the last minute because I have another session starting right 1 minute before, so Jane will wrap up at the end, but then now I will let the gentleman there have his questions and then all the others.
Fahimullah Shigewal from Afghanistan. I have three questions. That how many users can be connected to this router? Then what's the difference between this community network and Wi-Fi networks we have? Can we find the equipment or the router of this system, community networks on the market?
You have very extensive questions. Let's say that there are, community networks are also Wi-Fi network, can be Wi-Fi network. Limit of users is up to how much you manage to scale. Gifinet has 90,000 users. There are a lot of information that you can find both in this book and also in the previous two books that we have released. They are all for free. But that are only some of the resources, of course. Unless someone has a very quick reply to those questions that are quite extensive, I hope you will
forget me, if, forgive me, sorry, not forget. if I go to the next question. Okay, is there anyone have a quick
reply? Yeah. You can approach the rest of the people during the IGF, I think, or just outside here and later to speak more about this.
Okay, thanks. This is my first time, therefore I asked many questions.
No problem. You're more than welcome. It's wonderful that you have this kind of questions, and fortunately you will find a lot of answers here. It's only a question of time. It's not lack of will to reply. Question there.
Good morning, Paul Rowley. I'm a JAMBAC member, but don't kill me. 6 months ago, we didn't have a venue, so we're actually quite fortunate to have this venue, although it's not ideal. Next year will be better, I believe. My issue is not really an issue. I think one of our challenges is definitely the regulator. I work and live in Africa, and it's not a technology issue. It's getting the regulators that are often ignorant to understand what community networks can do to enable us to connect the last billions. So what can we do to get that voice that will enable the regulators to actually listen to us when you've got other voices that are pushing other agendas which don't necessarily work in the same objectives that we're trying to achieve here, you know, like the big mobile operators and GMSA and the ITU, etc. Thank you.
Does anyone want to reply? I can start a reply by saying that if you already have research showing that things are feasible and regulation can be adapted to make it fit also community networks, already a very good start. But I think Roger has also another reply to share with you.
Just a comment. When we talk about connecting the next billions, we have to learn from something, and it's connecting those who are already connected. Because if we just restrict ourselves, that means say marginalize ourselves to those areas that are not profitable for the commercial solutions, this is a mistake. We will not reach this point we were discussing before, the break-even point, and then be able to scale up. And this is important when talking about also to the regulator, and not to deliver the message that this is just for where the commercials don't want to deploy their networks. This is, at least for me, it's wrong.
Exactly. So in this room, there will be also sections on spectrum right after this one.
My name is Siva Subramaniam. I'm from India. Just a broad general idea and a question. A lot of work has been done on community networks, but so far, in the majority of instances, the scale of the community network has been small to medium. And having done so much work, is it possible that the community pays attention to building large-scale community networks, probably with tier 4 connectivity from an internet service provider, tier 1 connectivity, and make it as large as a national or a regional community network, and like a huge operation with a community network pricing model? That would be very, very beneficial. Not only aiming at the unconnected, but also aiming at the connected. Thank you.
I think it's Leandro and Roger have very good answers to your questions, and also you will find them in this book. I thank you very much for your time, and I have to run now. So I will let Jane wrap up the work.
Let's have 10 seconds.
Go ahead, Leandro.
Just a quick comment. The size is the objective. The size, scalability, sustainability is the topic of our chapter. And I can give you a quick example from our experience. I remember about 5 years ago, Wifinet had four times more, let's say, super nodes, we call it, than mobile base stations in the same territory of about 500 kilometers of diameter. So density was already higher than any other mobile operator. And in terms of the ecosystem, there are multiple 10 gigabit connections to the internet. It has, in a study we did along the different companies, cities and communities and universities connected to the internet in Spain, it was among the best in quality. And in terms of companies, there are about probably more than 20 companies which are operating on top of the commons, on the commons infrastructure. They are contributing to the cost. And for instance, one of the biggest one of the, let's say, commercial operators using or participating in the Gifinet infrastructure has about 10,000 users in a small area. So it's a kind of a healthy and big ecosystem.
And Shiva, there are many people here who can help you with this later. And so I'm going to turn to Raul for literally 30 seconds, because we have to wrap it up. And I'll be very brief, so we can shift the room over, because we really have to go quickly. OK, so you have 30 seconds.
Yep. Thank you. That's more than I need. Mine is a very short comment. And Don raised the issue here that of the resilience that the network has to like physical disasters, but I would also like want to point out that it can also be resilient against policy disasters like censorship. That's all.
Ten seconds. No, I just wanted to mention when we talked about regulation that we are having some interesting advances in regulation. What we haven't been able yet is to have the regulators find a way to channel funds from the universal service funds to community networks. There are, I think, no examples yet, or no? Or maybe, well, okay, not that I know of. So I think at least in the CNC, in the Community Network Special Interest Group from ISOC, we are talking about this as a special issue.
Thank you very much, everyone. And we would like to note that the director of the Argentine regulatory body, ANACOM, just came in, and he's going to be on our panel. So he's a great example of someone that's actually working to change laws and regulations in his own country. So I just would like to say, Luca asked me to ask every single speaker who spoke earlier, not the question and answer part, but the speakers, you need to send him one sentence, a message about what you said. We have to report back in 12 hours. It's quite, there's a lot of good work being done here, and the IGF wants us to turn this around quickly. But bottom line is, thank you to everyone for what you're doing. You're helping connect people who aren't connected from the village or the community out. This is rural, remote, and underserved, which includes urban. So thank you very much. We're going to switch over the panels and have a good afternoon. Spectrum is up next. Okay, thank you.